The views expressed in the following program are those of the participants and do not necessarily reflect the views of Saga 960 AM or its management.
I'm Annie Koshy, and I'm glad that you've joined me for In Focus with Annie J. Koshy, where I look at people and their milestones, places where international change makers are impacting our world, as well as events that bring our communities together. You can tune in on Saturdays at 4 p.m. to News Talk Saga 960 AM. Follow Saga 960 AM on Instagram and on Facebook, and you can follow me as well on Instagram under Annie J. Koshy or under GTA South Asia Media Network. Sundar Viswanathan, an award-winning and multi-JUNO-nominated jazz and world artist. It is such a pleasure that I'm going to be having him in studio today, that he's going to be speaking with me. It is such a treat for all of you listening. He is considered one of Canada's most diversely talented artists. He's highly respected in the international musical circles as an ambassador, as well as an educator. Welcome to the show, Sundar.
Thank you, Annie. It's great to be here.
Now, you were born in South India, and I'm very familiar with the place that you were born because I had family there. It is the beautiful hill station, Ooty. And tell me about your early years. I know that they were filled with music, and you were really part of a musical family.
Yeah. We didn't spend a lot of time in Ooty. I mean, I was born there. I think we were there for several months, but we went back to Coimbatore in Tamil Nadu, where my mom's side of the family was. And my grandfather, I remember, had a big house with a compound, you know, like in the old days, space. And we had a lot of space, and we had an upstairs terrace and outdoor terrace. So I would, you know, sleep on the terrace when I was very small. I also, like you say, came up in a musical family. And my mother's side of the family, my uncles were, and my mom and her sisters were always singing, and they also played instruments. So my uncles had a band.
The Spiders.
It's called The Spiders, yeah.
That's right. Yeah. Now, it's quite interesting. The influence that you had at that time was mainly Beatles, Jim Reeves. We all grew up with these sort of classics, right? Now, did you play as part of your uncle's band at all?
I played with my full-heartedly on the pans, pots and pans.
Yeah, so you did rhythm, did you?
Oh, yeah. They said I had a very good rhythm when I was young. I used to keep the beat with as they played.
Do you think you were born with this in your blood? Music was just part of your soul.
I think there's something to that. I don't know whether it is coming from the womb or what. But, but being surrounded, the environment that I had was always musical. It was always music happening. My parents and my relatives were into Bollywood music and Kollywood music.
Right.
So that was always happening there. So music was around me all the time.
Now, your story, your background, your early childhood is very parallel to mine. Similar to your parents, mine also migrated to the States to do their higher education. Your father went to Kentucky to work on his master's degree, and his wife, your mom, joined him later on. Now, I want to talk about things that you faced. Your family eventually moved from the U.S. to Canada. You moved to north of Toronto to a place called Sudbury, and that was very unusual. What brought your family to Sudbury?
Well, my dad got offered, I think it was probably some kind of intensive TA ship, or I don't think it was a professorship yet, but it was very close to being a professorship. In Sudbury, Laurentian University. So we left Kentucky to go to Sudbury.
Right. That was also climate-wise would have been a huge change.
Yeah. There's a lot of changes. It was a big change. I was very young, but...
Now, you grew up there in a place where there weren't that many Indians. And I know that some of the things that you would have faced at the time was a curiosity, maybe an unacceptance of your differences. Did you face any of that during high school? What were your early years like?
Oh, yeah. There was a lot of, you're being very euphemistic about it. I call it racism.
Well, yeah, racism, bullying. I think we all, I was bullied as a kid. I was different. I was visibly different. My family did things differently. I dressed different. I spoke probably differently. Yeah. I didn't even know how to use a fork and knife really until the teacher placed a whole bunch of things on the table in grade five and said, okay, we're going to learn how to do setting a place at the table. And I looked at it and I went, well, we eat with our hands.
Yeah. Yeah. No, there was all that. And racism was a problem. I mean, from as far as I can remember in my childhood, up to high school. And high school is when it really got worse, actually. And high school is not my favorite time in my life. Let's put it that way.
Yeah, it wasn't mine either. You know, I just didn't fit in. And I can relate completely to what you were saying. I was also very shy. And I think you were also shy and not confident. Definitely not the individuals that we are today, where we couldn't care less what other people think of us now, right? We've attained a certain sort of leather skin. But at that time, we just wanted to fit in and we didn't fit in. And it was really hard. And now you have a brother, and you and your brother founded the Sudbury Brothers. Tell us about this rock band.
That was our rock band, Sudbury Brothers. I mean, we played mostly stuff that we heard on the radio. We did some Police. We did some Platinum Blonde.
Oh, yeah. I remember Rush, Pink Floyd. Rush,
Bryan Adams. There was a bunch of things. I played guitar in that band. So I was a guitar player. My first instrument that I studied. Practiced was guitar.
And so funny you say that. Yeah. It was what kept us, it was our exposure to the world of music, really. You know?
Yeah. And that's what kept me. I mean, that's being, you know, not being, say, popular. And mm-hmm. not, you know, I had my friends, but, you know, they were all very introverted. And, you know, we had our own sort of like geek squad.
Oh, I'm so happy you said that. We had our own geek squad. It was the one that you felt you felt a part of because, yeah. You know, we didn't have the, I don't know, it was penny loafers and Roots paraphernalia at that time, the sweatshirts, yeah. The pinstriped shirts with the button down collars and all that sort of stuff that I didn't fit in. And
no. I mean, the geeks of yesterday are the people who are the successful people of today, I guess.
Thanks. I think I'm going to keep you, Sundar, in my world. Now, you know, we have so much to cover in today's show because your experience, your journey as an artist, your work has been so extensive and for so long. And there's so much that we have in common as well to talk about. And we're going to take a short break right now, but when we come back, we're going to dive right into your journey into jazz, the jazz world, and how it was transitioning from someone who had listened to a lot of Indian music into the world of jazz, which was not sometimes an easy journey to make. You're tuned into In Focus with Annie J. Koshy here on Saga 960. I'm going to take a short break right now. When we come back, we're going to continue this conversation with this amazing world artist.
Stream us live at saga960am.ca.
Welcome back to In Focus with Annie J. Koshy, and we're in conversation with Sundar Viswanathan, saxophonist, a flutist, a bansurist, composer, and vocalist, who is the creator of Avatar, a musical fusion of classical Indian music, modern jazz, Brazilian lyricism, and so much more with the dash of contemporary improvisation. Now, Sundar, thank you so much for joining us here on the Saturday. I want to jump into the fact, what I had just ended off in our previous segment with, and that is developing that discernment as a jazz musician from having the year of listening to Indian classical. How was that journey for you?
Yeah, there's a lot of transitioning that had to happen. I had come from this other world in music, Indian music, classical and Bollywood, actually. And my first exposure outside of when I left home in university was actually classical, Western classical music. Mm-hmm. And so that was what I studied first. And then that it's, you know, there was a certain training there and it integrated me into another way of thinking and hearing music. And then from there, it was jazz after that. And it was a tricky transition. I mean, both very different styles with some similarities, but technically there was a lot of changes that I had to make. So it really took a while to really, a lot of really intensive focus on the new genre and getting into the sound and hearing and listening.
No, it's quite interesting. I played trumpet when I was in high school and I never owned a trumpet. I was very lucky that I had the exposure through band to that world of bands, big bands, brass bands, playing in a band, the necessary things. I would never have had that exposure had I been in India and studying there. I don't think I would have had that opportunity. So I'm really grateful that I had that, you know, ability. Did you own your instruments in high school? When did you first own your first saxophone? When did you?
Good question. Because I didn't actually own my own saxophone until I hit university. I had no idea that I was going to go into music. I actually thought I was going to go into computer science because I did. Wow. I loved, like, you know, making these little video games using basic programming when the first computers. But my math, I wasn't like you. I wasn't really into math at the time. And I didn't see, then I realized that, you know, I dropped math in grade 13, so there's really no scope for me going to computer science. In those days, you had no.
Yeah, we needed, for those of you listening, you're wondering, what is grade 13? Yes, those of us, we're not going to mention the unmentionable, but there was a time when there was grade 13 in this province and we had to go for that one extra. We just feel we're a little wiser because of that. But without grade 13, you couldn't go off to university. And coming from a South Asian background, it was unheard of that we did not go off to university, especially if you had academic parents, as both of us did. So your first instrument you owned when you went off to university, and you know, you had this vision that you were going to go off to Miami and do a master's degree in jazz. First off, were your family supportive of the fact that you decided you wanted to do something that was out of the box of the usual?
Well, there's some pushback. I mean, you know, they're still, you know, engineering, medicine, you know, those are two.
Yeah, so are the five careers, right? Computer science, teaching, engineering, medicine, dentist, right. Maybe a veterinarian.
Yeah, I actually only heard engineering and medicine back in those days. But my dad, like you say, was a professor. So, and his very quickly, his trajectory, his dad tried to force him to go into mathematics and he failed miserably. So he went into social work and he enjoyed that. So he realized that maybe, you know, if I don't like math, maybe that's not my path. And they said, okay, if you go into music, you have to get doctorate, only doctorate to go into music. You know, that was the thing. You had to go. So it was that. So yeah, they were supportive if I got a doctorate eventually, you know.
Right. So they would say that they had already witnessed your brilliance at a young age and knew you were good at. Well, I think as parents are concerned whether it could be something that is lucrative enough to be able to support a family, be able to sustain yourself and to make ends meet, all of the things that parents really want their kids to. So there you were. You were off to Miami to do your master's, but something changed. What happened?
Yeah, I thought I was going to Miami. I was looking forward to the heat, but then I got a letter and phone call from New England Conservatory in Boston, saying, "Hey, look, we didn't hear back from you in the scholarship." I said, "What scholarship?" I didn't hear scholarship. They said, "Oh, we got a, you know, good scholarship for you to come to New England." I was like, "All right, I guess I'm going to New England."
So, wow, you learned from some amazing jazz teachers there. Anyone who stands out in your mind?
Well, one is George Garzon, who is he's one of the top guys in top tenor saxophonists in the world right now.
Yeah,
and you know, he has a particular concept of teaching and playing, and he was a really great mentor. There's several. I mean, I could name a bunch, but he was the guy I mainly studied with.
Now, you realize at this point that as an artist, you needed to develop a thicker skin. What were some of the things that you went through that started to develop that that spin, that skin that, you know, you weren't so concerned what other people were saying and doing.
That's a tough one. And it's still an ongoing thing, right? It's still a growing experience and learning experience. But no, I have to say, when I was young, I had a very thin skin, very, very, you know, hyper like sensitive, but many things, and shy, like you said. And it took a while of getting like beaten down to just, you know, forcibly, you know, being, you know, told that I couldn't play and being fired from bands. And
right. There's one incident with George Russell. You want to elaborate on that incident that happened? So,
George Russell is a theorist, and he was a musician and composer. He died several years ago, but he was kind of a legend in the world of theory, jazz theory. Everyone knows who he is, who knows about jazz. But he was teaching at New England. He was this imposing figure. And I played in his group, and I was playing, and I just got a new tenor saxophone. I'm mostly an alto sax player. And I was learning how to get a sound in the tenor. I was getting better at it. And he stops and he goes, you know, hey, wait a minute. You're a tenor player. I played with Coltrane. I played with Sonny Rollins. I played with all those guys. You're supposed to have fire, man. You're supposed to have fire. And he kicked me out of this band. I didn't know, you know, you leave. And then because I was such a good reader, having come from classical music, he got me back in because nobody could play the book, right?
Right.
So he got me back in. And then at the end of the year, he said, you know, I got better. I practiced it. Yeah, yeah. Man, you're all right. But, you know, I'll never forget that experience because it was really embarrassing. And also it taught me something. I went back and I continued my eight hour a day practice, you know.
It's funny you say that because we see someone who has reached success. And I wrote about that, you know, recently in something that I put out about success. And often people gauge success on how other people view you, but success is really an internal determination of whether you've reached your own goals. And I think your resolve at that time to find success in an instrument that you had no familiarity with, but to be told that this is a benchmark that you need to get to, you put those thoughts into an action and put those steps one by one to get to that level of success.
Yeah. Right? I mean, there was all kinds of work along the way. I mean, it's like personal work, right? It's not even music work. It's just working on becoming a better human being. And then you become a better musician and vice versa. You know, you cannot become, I mean, you know, maybe some people will cite some exceptions, but you cannot become a great musician without becoming a great human being.
Right.
And just learning, you know, if anything, you learn about yourself. And and then I've also studied a lot of things. I've read a lot of books. I've been to a lot of seminars and that's part of my pathway. It's just becoming better and understanding how things are, the perspective of things within my career.
And I'm going to talk about that when we get to our last segment, because it is really reflected in Worldview, in the album that Akhtar has put out. And I'm going to talk about some of that later on, because your mindset, the way you've created your music, the way you have added the soul to your music comes from your everyday, comes from that mindset, comes from what you're seeing around in the world around you. And that's been there. But I'm not there yet. I've got lots to talk to you about before we get there. I want to talk about your stay in Boston, where you had lots of opportunities to play, do gigs on the boats that were coming in there, and also to meet a lot of amazing musicians. You spent a lot of time practicing and performing with some amazing people, people like Bobby Vinton. Tell us about that experience, because he's very well known. He's considered to be, you know, one of the most successful love song singers, you know, of the rock era. And he's also known as a Polish prince. Yeah. How lovely was that, right?
A lot of those musicians were from the cruise ships, like you mentioned.
Yeah.
That happened sort of my later years after my undergrad into masters. But yeah, I played with Bobby Vinton, a bunch of other people like Charo and...
She was amazing. She started playing that flamenco guitar at the age of 9, and such a young age. You know, some of these people who are legendary musicians really, I feel, were born like you with a musician gene in them, right? Yeah. There was an affinity to this music, and it's coming from the soul. Al Martino, who went on to play Johnny Fontaine, I believe, in The Godfather. You also performed with him.
Yeah, the thing about these guys, they all came from the old school mentality of performing. They were entertainers,
right?
Most, and they were very, very on their mind. Like, I knew they're like really high level. Actually, they really knew what they were doing. They did it, and they had their show, and you had to do their show just like this and like that. And they had the music, and the music was very scored out. You know, very perfectly scored out. And they would tell you if they wanted something different, they would point at you and say, "You, I need you to do this." Or, "You, I need you to do this. What are you doing over there? No, don't play those notes like that. Do this." No, there's
there was a musicality as well as a precision, I would say, in how they were doing it. And they ran a very tight ship. Right. And it was counted. It was a very, the fact that they were on a cruise ship and they ran a tight ship, you know, gosh, you got to say that, right? But very true. There was a precision about it, and it was timed in, and it was, you know, it was exact amount. There was the improvisation, I would say, would be limited in how they were doing it. Right. Now, you went from there at some point, moved to also New York City. You finally decided you wanted to do that coveted PhD. Let's talk about that.
Yeah. So Boston was a really good experience in terms of, I was still practicing quite a bit and meeting a lot of contacts and networking. But the place to really get to for all jazz musicians in New York, right? So New York was, I had to go there and play there. So there was a PhD program there. And the people that were teaching there, some really amazing teachers, all from the spectrum of New York City. And that was a place to go and perform. And like I say, if you make it there, you make it anywhere. So, I went there. Found a bunch of musicians that I knew from before, got into some networks and started jamming with different places with different people and some very well-known artists. It was just a really great experience.
Yeah, it was also a rude awakening for you because it was, I guess you could say, the tightening of that screw, the fine-tuning of you as an artist, the nuances of how you were going to be later on was happening here. You were really going through the fire part of making sure that you had that grit and tenacity and experience and range so that you can do more. I think the artists and musicians that you were exposed to in New York City were really a tad on a different level. Do you agree with that?
There's some equally good musicians in Boston, but the amount of musicians in New York that were of a high level was more than you were any place in the world. I mean, the scrutiny was intense, and if you weren't working on your music or if you weren't looking to find gigs, somebody else was. And it is, they used to say, if you're not looking for a gig, if you're not practicing, someone else is going to take your gig and is going to practice, you know? I got to hang out with people like Billy Hart, the drummer who played with Miles Davis, Jim McNeely, who played piano with Stan Getz, and Donald Byrd, the trumpet player, artist, legend. A lot of guys like that were people that I was able to play with, and just phenomenal, phenomenal musicians.
When we come back, we're going to speak about Ensemble Uniqua, which was a band that you were a part of and did a number of gigs in New York City. You're tuned into In Focus with Annie J. Koshy here on Saga 960. I'm in conversation with Sundar Viswanathan. We're going to take a short break right now, and I'll be back right after this message.
No radio? No problem. Stream us live on saga960am.ca.
Welcome back to In Focus with Annie J. Koshy, where we are speaking to Sundar Viswanathan, a jazz woodwind player, composer, vocalist, and international touring artist who has extensive performance and teaching experience in US and Canada. We were speaking just before the break on Ensemble Uniqua. Let's talk about that. You performed several gigs with them. How was this such an important moment for you?
Oh, well, the funny thing is I met the main leader from Uniqua was from Boston. I knew him in Boston, and I lost touch with him because I'd gone back to Canada for a year and then come back to New York. And then I ran to him in the subway and just, can we start a, let's, I'm doing a, starting a band. Let's do this. So we started this band, we were rehearsing, we played all kinds of gigs and dives. But those were some of the best gigs because the energy was real hot and we were really into it. We were young. We had so, we were very positive. You know, it was, and audiences were eating it up. It was kind of like jazz meets African music meets some Indian music. It was, you know, the world.
World music, you know?
Yeah. Very strong African because we had a percussionist as well as a drummer. Everybody was keen and we played so many gigs together and we did some tours, in the States. We came up to Canada, did a bit of a thing. So that was a really important sort of crafting for my particular approach to music and the way I thought about my composing too. And then also gave me, put me in a position where, you know, I was kind of, you know, I was always the one who had to play the fastest tunes because I was a sax player. There's a trumpet player and violinist, but I had to play this. So they always look at me and they'd stop. And within the band, there's a lot of competition. So people would, like, when you'd be playing on the bandstand, they'd come and stand right in front of you, in front of your face while you're playing, improvising. Literally, it was kind of like fun competition, right? We'd like try to get each other, make each other screw up on bandstand, right? But this
did you ever? Did you mess up? What's a moment that you?
Not usually. It was pretty good. Like I learned to focus, and then you find your space, right? Very rarely. I can't remember actually messing. Not that I don't mess up my life, but you know.
Well, I tried to. You know, I recently saw you performing at Hughes Room Live, and I was photographing. And I remember at one point thinking, "Is he going to kill me after he's going to come and talk to me and say, 'Don't get in my face like that'' because I was right under you when you were playing the bansuri, right? And I was there. I was with this big lens, you know, shooting up at you. And I know from your peripheral vision, you'd be able to sort of see me at the, you know, the bottom there, and you're trying to read music and, you know.
I don't notice these things. I mean, when I play, I kind of go blind for everything else.
Yeah. Fade out everything else. And it's just,
the ear comes in, the eyes go out, you know?
Yeah. So I think you speak about the fact that New York City really helped, you learn about focus, about determination, about the attitude to success, but also it was not an easy place for you to live in either. What were some of the challenges as a musician that you faced? Because many people listening right now see you as a successful artist, but don't realize all of the steps that you took to get to that point.
Well, I mentioned some of them was, you know, coming up across obstacles in the music world where, you know, maybe you weren't quite up to the bar on something, but you took the gig anyway because you wanted to do it. And then, you know, you had to practice, you know, you had to go in there and practice. That was one thing, is like you had to always be working towards these things. So there's a lot of pressure to succeed and to be at your level. And part of it, maybe I put on myself, but there's that. And there's also the fact that New York's a very hard city. It was before 9/11. It was more hard. I'll attest to that. But it was a very hard city. The attitude, the people there. I felt like coming back home to Toronto, I needed to do that every, you know, 6-7 months. Come back to a village like Toronto, you know, from New York, you know, because Toronto.
I don't think Toronto appreciates that right now, Sundar. I think from my perspective, I would see New York almost like Bombay or Mumbai, as it's called now, right? That bustle, that everyone's, you know, packed into crammed quarters, and it's a city that never sleeps. And New York is like that as well.
Very intense, and that's why coming back to Toronto was so nice. You know, it was nice to come back to a peaceful city, right?
I like that. I like that you have us as a laid back city.
compared to New York, yeah. I mean, there's different things about it. But New York was hard. It was a hard place to live for a while. And it was, you know, it was loud. It was dirty. It was intense. It was, you know, there was a lot of people who were, you know, it wasn't a kind city, let's say. Great city. Not a kind city. And for musicians, that also stands to true, I think.
Right. Now, you had the opportunity at that point, once you were in New York, to come back to Toronto and to make Toronto more of a permanent location for you. You moved from being just a musician to starting your journey as a professor. Let's talk about that transition.
Yeah. So I had not quite finished my doctorate yet. I was finished everything but my dissertation. And I was working on my dissertation. My dad had threatened to go on a hunger strike if I didn't finish my dissertation. Literally, he was going to do that. He came to New York and sat there and said, "I'm going to go on a hunger strike if you don't finish." But luckily, I got that job. And I came back to Toronto. And then it was a whole different experience jumping from the seat of a student to the seat of someone in as an authority figure, I guess. And it took a while for me to transition. I sort of didn't see myself that way. Like, I had taught before. I taught at New England. I taught at Humber. I mean, I went back, taught at Humber for a year and a few other places, the schools and things like that. And so I had some experience, but it didn't, like, being a professor was a different thing. It was just, I felt way more different kind of pressure on myself to sort of live up to the expectations of that position, whatever it might be.
Yeah, teaching is something that you have a lot of people who are talented as, you know, in an area, but that doesn't necessarily make them great teachers. And great teachers may be good at one area, but they're not good at multiple, you know, wearing multiple hats. For you, what was the most challenging part of moving yourself from being a musician, in which you just expressed how you felt about music, you did it through an instrument, to having to try to share that knowledge with a person who doesn't have any background in it, trying to instill that passion in them about an area that you're passionate about?
Yeah, I mean, luckily, because undergrads, they come in with some knowledge and experience, expertise. But the challenge for me was more about, or was not organizational. That's one thing. That's on a different level. Other one was, you know, I'd been used to looking at music in a critical way, in the sense of like thinking about music analytically all through, because of trying to develop my career. So I had those things. I had all the maps and things of how to become a better musician, what needs to be done. My thing was also, I wasn't able to right away gauge where a student was. Maybe right. I was expecting too much of a student, and I expect them to know too much about certain things because I knew it. And I just didn't know, maybe I couldn't understand why they didn't understand this concept. And so I had to really back up. After a few years of teaching, I had to back up and say, hey, okay, I got to just give less information, you know, slower, and kids are not getting it, right?
Right. And so I think those are the lessons as teachers that we learn, is that it's not about if a student is good or bad. It's about how well as a teacher we're able to relay knowledge and how well that other person receives it. And if they haven't received it as a teacher, we tweak how we share it. Yes. We tweak how we impart that knowledge. And that's a lesson that when you're really good at picking up things that you don't know and then running with it, which is the type of person that you are. I see that already. You take an instrument that you don't know and you learn about it. You take it apart. You finally master it. I think the journey of becoming a teacher, a professor, was also something that's a journey in progress. Because you're a musician or because you're a great teacher doesn't make you great in certain areas, perhaps like you mentioned about organization, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
And sometimes it's about being able to be of school or university or colleges sometimes have a more traditional mindset where you have a certain syllabus you have to impart. You have certain assessments that you have to give. You have certain rubrics you have to provide. You have structures that as a musician, you don't. You just go up on stage and perform, right?
Yeah. Yeah. There's different structures in music, obviously. But it does. Yeah. It takes definitely being an academic. It requires some different ways of thinking. In some ways, doing the doctorate, the dissertation, I still have a lot of creativity left, but it kind of kicked some creativity out of me in terms of writing this text, because it's a scientific method, you know, and all that.
And you had to focus. Your focus in your dissertation was quite enlightening. It was about exploring the philosophical end of making art, if that's correct, right? Did you struggle with that at the time? Was the dissertation hard to write for you?
Yeah, there were some things that I wasn't used to looking at and things that I had to look from different perspectives that, you know, I had to read more to learn about this and find out about how to look at something from, you know, to view it from a different way so that it gave the bigger picture of all of it. So there's some learning things that had to be done for sure.
And you had to, you focused, I think, on a tenor saxophonist, Joe Henderson, at that point, right? In your dissertation. Now, I want to move on to a huge shift that happened for you. And this was when you performed several times here in Toronto for the, in BAM, for the BAM Festival of the Arts. You were a resident artist in resident at that point there. But it was through that experience that some things changed in your mind. What occurred at that point?
Yeah, so that what they did is these band festivals in the summer, they choose from like maybe 50 hundreds of applicants from around the world. And you go there and you study with master teachers, you know, and so, you know, those were some of the people who were really up, you know, echelons. And for me, the first time I did that at Banff was the big thing for me was trusting myself in the music and not relying on music that was in front of me, learning tunes and going back to playing by ear, which is where how I learned to play first.
Right.
Trusting myself in the jazz world to play that way. That was a big learning, big light bulb experience for me.
It was like almost unlearning the sheet music aspect, right? Of going back to playing, to feeling music and feeling the mood and feeling where it was taking you. And because you knew your instrument so well at this point and you knew how the next note should perhaps sound to match what was going on, you were able to do that. And it was really when you started to trust yourself, I think, trust your ability. And that was huge. Now, you went on to join a band that was a JUNO-nominated. They actually won a JUNO. This is Jaffa Road. Let's speak about Jaffa Road.
Yeah, sure. Thank you, Annie, for giving us the JUNO. We actually never won one, but I
well, you were nominated, okay, for the for the JUNO. I guess it was for the album Sunplace
and... oh God, I'm forgetting. Just two of the albums.
Yeah, there was another couple. And also, I think, did they come out with another song in 2020 or 2021? Yeah, another album?
Another album this year, yeah.
Yeah.
And so that was great because that is a kind of led by an oud player who plays Turkish oud. And then, so we all get together and collaborate. This is more of a collaborative effort than I've ever been in terms of a band.
Right. Yeah, it speaks to the diversity of Toronto, really, because Aaron Lightstone, I mean, you've got the Hebrew, you've got Indian, you've got Jewish, you've got, you know, your oud player. They're all really reflective of different communities, different sounds, different musical sort of, it's a blending, I would say, right? The Western, the grooviness of it, the hip.
There's a pop sensibility too, right? That was brought into this band, which is different than anything I played with before. And actually, I gotta say that some of those sensibilities that gave us some audiences, it was kind of nice to play to like full houses. You know, if you're playing eclectic music, it's, you know, maybe not as well attended. So that was kind of nice to get that and then get the JUNO nominations. It was nice to be appreciated in that way, you know, for that kind of music as still art music, you know.
Absolutely. Well, we're going to come back because there is one more part that I want to talk to you about, Sundar, and this is about Avatar. It's a musical fusion of classical Indian music, modern jazz, Brazilian lyricism, so much more. And I have to say, this band was amazing. It was my first concert in 2 years that I went to listen to just a couple of weeks ago, and they were amazing. We're in Focus with Annie J. Koshy here on Jazz FM, and I'm speaking with Sundar Viswanathan. We're going to take a short break right now, and I'll come back right after this message.
Stream us live at saga960am.ca.
Welcome back to In Focus with Annie J. Koshy, and we are in conversation with Sundar Viswanathan, who is equally comfortable within the jazz world as well as in world music. He's a saxophonist, a flutist, a bansurist, composer, and vocalist. His work on standard compositions and original material has been heard on stages all over the world, especially in North America, here in Canada and the U.S. Now, I want to talk about an album, Sundar, that you have just received a JUNO nomination for. Welcome back to the show. And let's speak about Avatar and Worldview.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, we're very happy and humbled to be part of the JUNO nominees for Best Jazz Album of the Year group. this year for Worldview. This band has been together for over 10 years and it's changed personnel over the years. There's been a few people who have maintained in the group. Our singer Felicity Williams has been with the band since the beginning. The tabla player Ravi Naipali with the band from the beginning.
And I know Ravi as well from my days at Jazz FM. So right. Shout out to Ravi. Yes.
Absolutely. And then we picked up, you know, along the way, we had people like Rich Brown in the band and Robbie Botos played in the band.
Yeah.
Lots of people, Rakesh Tiwari and et cetera, like a lot of people. But we sort of settled in on this configuration, I'd say about six years, oddish, 6 or 7 years ago.
Right. And you've got Michael Occupinti right now, as well as Max Sennett as well.
And then on drums, Michael Occupinti on guitar.
Right.
And Justin Gray on the bass.
That's right.
Yeah, really, everybody has sort of really their own sort of trajectory where they've come from musically. I mean, to give you an idea, we ranges from like Felicity sings in the pop world, but also in avant-garde, in singer-songwriter stuff and really eclectic background. Justin Gray comes from training also in jazz, but also in Indian classical music, Hindustani music. He studied very
heavily. Yeah, absolutely. There was one song that you guys performed. I think it was the last song that was such a blend of Indian sounds with Western, and he had this section that he played. It was just incredible on that. And Felicity, just so I want to give a shout out, and I want to focus on these artists individually as well, because each of them have had their own unique musical journeys. But Felicity's range, her vocal range is just incredible. At one point, I watched your eyebrows just go up when she hit that top, when she hit those top notes. You know, now this album, let's talk about the album. Worldview has been nominated for a Juno Award for Jazz Album of the Year under group. Now, the album is a reflection of the state of our world. And when you started developing the songs and music for it, was it during the pandemic
that you started? Yes. It was kind of crossed over from before the pandemic into the pandemic. It took a, you know, there was a time period when I was working on the songs, about a year probably. And there was a lot of things going on politically in our world, in North America, that were happening just before the pandemic. And then with the pandemic and isolation and the fear that was happening and uncertainty. For me, what ties this whole album together is a couple of things. One is is my thoughts around how children are affected by all the different things that are happening in our world.
Yeah.
Whether it be the decisions of our so-called leaders, I guess in some way, you know, poor decisions. Yeah, there's good decisions here and there, but
and those who do lead with integrity and compassion. You know, I guess the juxtaposition of both of those ideals, right? How someone leads, and a world perspective on that.
Yeah. And those things coming out, like the fake news bit and all this other things, some crazy stuff that was happening and coming up. And kids, you know, kids just take things for face value and they see what's happening and they're affected. And they don't know, you know, why they have certain thing has to be a certain way. You know, why do we have to leave our country to go to another country because, you know, there's a war? Why are people fighting? What is going on here? Why are we staying in a refugee camp? Things like that. And kids, you know, they just want to be kids. And I have two young kids that
and I think your song Little Kurdi was a reflection of the brokenness of the innocence of children being sort of taken away. It's, you know, it's that little Syrian boy that washed up on the shores several years ago that we all saw that heartbreaking image of the blue pants and the shirt and it just broke my heart, right? And and now we are seeing some of these images of children, you know, in the conflict that's happening in Ukraine, and it's a repeat of it, right? The tribute. Tell us about how you were writing. It's funny that a lot of your beautiful music has actually stemmed from a lot of heartache.
Yeah. I think I mentioned that at the concert. I wish there were more happy things that I wrote about, but a lot of things that I wrote, but you know, at the end of the day, I am thinking about what we can do. What can we do differently? You know, I think the point is music has to stimulate people to make change too. And to do things differently. Think about things more deeply. I think as artists, we look at things maybe with a different eye, and it's our responsibility to help other people see it in that way. And if, you know, it means, you know, making a change in your life in some way, a positive change, then that would, you know, would make, you know, make it worthwhile doing the art. So it was difficult to write some of this music, and it took a while, and it took a lot of sort of inward thinking, almost like a meditation that happens before I write. And then the music starts to just come out, and I get to that zone, the music starts to come out. I sing into a tape recorder, and then I write it down later, you know, and then I organize everything later on. So the inspiration, you know, when it moves you, you know, that word moves you a certain way, stuff has to come out creatively.
Where can people get a hold of you if they want to reach out to learn more about Worldview or to know where you're performing next? What's the best place to get a hold of you?
Yeah. One thing is to go to my website, sundarmusic.com. That's www.sundarmusic.com. And then they can also, if they want to check the CD out, they can also go to Bandcamp, which is a site where a lot of musicians use. So it's actually Avatar, AVATAAR. bandcamp.com. I should mention that please make sure you put an AVATAAR if you're searching for the band Avatar and put band, because there is a Swedish death metal band named Avatar, which is not our band.
Yes, I noticed that. Or you'll get the blue people from the movie.
That's right. Yeah.
So now I was honored to be able to listen to all of you in concert just a little while, as I mentioned, and there were several songs that all of you played that were incredible. The talent within the band is just awe-inspiring. It was my first concert after having been, in a home for the last 2 years, pretty much. It was great to be back, especially also to be back at Hugh's Room, which also went through their share of woes during this time. And it was great to be back in the company of musicians. Well, there you have it. Are you interested in being on my show? Just reach out to me at info@saga960am.ca. Attention, Annie or the Ninja. If you've missed out on any of my live shows, you can tune in on Wednesdays for a repeat show from 9 to 10 p.m. You can also tune in on our website at www.sauga960am.ca, where there will be a podcast of this and other great shows. Well, I want you to have a wonderful, great Saturday afternoon. You know, I feel that the weather is warming up. We are at the last end of this horrible long winter. Snow, just go away. Not like song, which Sundar writes about in Worldview and sings about and performs in Worldview, but snow, I'm saying. So stay tuned to another show next week and stay safe. I'll be back again soon. Have a good afternoon.
No radio? No problem. Stream us live on saga960am.ca.